Oh man, four people. No, I was just about to say. Yeah, the weather is nice. And I was gonna ask, is something going on, man? Pretty my lowest turnout yet. I'll have to share this with my colleague. Well, luckily I record it. Well, yeah, no, hopefully more people show up. Some people show up a little later. I know Patricia was gonna come. She had questions on the lab. Oh, more people, yay. Oh, yay, 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 yay. Okay, I'm gonna start it over. Anyone know why I played that song specifically? Also, I'm hoping more people come, but whatever. The weather's nice, I get it. Been isolated and indoors, you know. Well, anyway, I played that song because it's gonna be May. So, funny. All right. So here's the warm-up, a couple questions. Go ahead and work on that. Kind of review some stuff from last time on blood type, and we'll talk about it in a few minutes. All right, I'll give you one more minute while I grab this spider up here. Try not to kill them, so I'm gonna go set them free. But sometimes you have to kill them because they're just too sneaky. All right. Number one, could a blood type A and a blood type B parent produce a blood type O child? Yes, they can. That's correct. So, Stacy, why? Why is it possible? What are the genotypes of the parents? Since that's harder to answer on a chat, how about I ask, are the parents homozygous or heterozygous? Exactly, they're heterozygous genotypes. So what does that look like? So this is number one. The answer is yes, because they can have heterozygous genotypes. So what would that look like in a Punnett square? Get some light on that. The two parents, one was blood type A, looks like that when it's heterozygous. The other was B. So when you do the cross, there's a 25% chance of having a child that's AB, which was an example of codominance, right? And then we have B here, an I, lowercase, A, I, little I. And then here's our 25% chance of blood type O for the child. Which completely lacks the surface sugars, A and B sugars on the red blood cells. That's why they call these people universal donors. You'll learn a little more about specifically why that is. If you take microbiology, it has to do with the immune system and rejection of a blood transplant, or a transfusion, sorry, and how that's very bad. You don't want your immune system to react against yourself. Okay, number two. Could a blood type AB parent and a blood type B parent produce a blood type O child? Is that possible? No, it's not. That's right. So the reason for that is because no matter what, if you have an AB parent, so AB, that's their genotype, the children are all going to inherit an allele, a dominant allele. And in order to be blood type O, you have to have two recessive alleles. So even if the blood type B parent had a recessive allele, there's just no way they'll have a blood type O child. Impossible. So this could be a fun way to determine. It's like, if their child's blood type O, maybe that spouse isn't so faithful. Nah, I'm saying. I think they actually do this sometimes in paternity testing and in court cases and whatnot. Could be a useful tool. But anyways, okay. Great. So this was number two, by the way. And the answer is no. So, all right, today's lecture, I'm gonna jump right into it. No announcements really. Other than the genetics of PTC lab due tomorrow, and I can stick around for anyone who has questions about it. I just kind of took a look at it myself and refreshed my mind with everything that the lab is covering. But today we're gonna wrap up genetics. So we're gonna talk kind of where we left off last time with another sort of variation on classic simple Mendelian genetics, which is the X-linked traits involving the X chromosome, which is one of the sex chromosomes. And then we're gonna go into really the most fundamental critical process in cells. And it's kind of like this topic that we're gonna focus on today for the majority of the lecture. If you leave my class forgetting everything but one thing, I want you to remember this this topic today, the concepts we cover. It's called, for this reason, it's called the central dogma of cell and molecular biology. It is the central process in all life that is crucial and explains really cell function across the board, and how genetic disease manifests, how certain normal cell processes occur, everything. So let's finish genetics first. So we left off talking about the X chromosome and how that can be a tricky situation regarding differences between this simple Mendelian pattern of inheritance, but we're gonna see there's a subtle, interesting thing about X-linked recessive traits, such as, so, it's very interesting. So these are the sex chromosomes, right? X and Y are two X's for females. It's really fascinating because the majority of the genes on the X chromosome have nothing to do really with male-female development. See, muscle development. So if there's a faulty gene for muscle development here, you get muscular dystrophy. Hemophilia, blood clotting. There's a blood clotting gene here. There's even a color sensory receptor gene for the eyes. It's very interesting that, and it also speaks to why, no matter what, you need an X chromosome. It's too important. You can't just have a Y or two Ys or that, which never can exist because only sperm cells can produce or have Y chromosomes, but you need at least one X. So let's take a look at the genetics and how it's different than classical Mendel. Similar, but some one key difference. It has to do with, again, your sex, male or female. So genes found on the X chromosome express differently. So genes found on X chromosome. By the way, I hate the name X chromosome. I don't think I told you why. And I always remind myself, I really want to convey this to students because it used to trip me up. I hate the name. Why do I hate the name? Take a look at the X chromosome. And you've seen it in a karyotype too. Does that look like an X to you? No, it's a single chromosome just like the rest of them, like a single strand. So it's the worst possible name because we deal with X-shaped chromosomes during DNA replication, the double-stranded chromosomes. So when I hear the X chromosome, I think you could have named it the frickin', like, anything else. That's the worst. So anyway. Just because it's named X doesn't mean it's always an X, right? With two sister chromatids. But genes found on the X chromosome express differently in males and females. Because the sex chromosomes are different. As I mentioned, males have one X chromosome and one Y chromosome. Females have two X chromosomes. One from mom, one from dad. Let's look at the male first, because the male is the different situation of sorts. Female, you'll find that it's exactly the same as what we've been talking about. But in a male, so the genotype is XY, right? Let's say, and remember, we're just talking about the X chromosome. First of all, let's talk about color blindness as an example. I forgot to write that. Let me write example. The example we're going to use is color blindness. So color blindness is an X-linked recessive trait. It's an X-linked recessive gene on the X chromosome, as we saw before on the slide. So colorblindness is an X-linked trait. Actually, add recessive, and I'll show you why that's important. X-linked recessive trait. Okay, so if a male has a normal X chromosome, so a normal colorblind gene, meaning it's producing the color detection receptor, whatever, protein. Normal gene, you're gonna get normal vision. Normal X, and the Y has nothing to do with it, right? So the phenotype for this male is normal vision, a normal vision male. Okay. If the male has a faulty, mutated gene, deficient, doesn't work, non-functional gene on that X chromosome. We denote it with a little c for colorblindness, like that. And then the Y, of course. Well, this is the reason that you're going to find X-linked traits are more common in males, because you only get one shot if you're a male, because we only have one X chromosome. So if you have a faulty gene on that X chromosome, you're going to be colorblind. So this is a colorblind male. You have the genetic disorder. Now, this is going to be different in females. So let's look at females. Do another color for fun. Yeah, that's right. let's look at females now. Now we're talking about two X chromosomes, right? Let's cover the first. If you have two normal alleles, two normal X chromosomes, functional versions of this gene for colorblindness, normal vision, right? Normal vision, female. Okay, next scenario would be one faulty gene, one color blindness allele. So that looks like this. Do you think this is normal? Will I write normal vision or color blindness here? What do you think? Yes. Ah, we got a color blindness. Okay, so carrier, yeah. So this will be a normal vision female. Why is that? Remember, we have two versions of every chromosome. Ha. Except males, we only got one X, but we have two versions of everything else. So actually, X chromosomes in females are considered a homologous pair, two versions of the same chromosome, two different chromosomes, two versions. Same gene, different allele possibly, right? Well, that saves you. You've got a normal functional version of that gene. So even though this is damaged, mutated, whatever, producing the wrong thing that's not going to work, well, this one produces the right thing. It overrides it. Male's only got one shot. If it's faulty, if it doesn't work, then you're colorblind. We don't have another normal functional version to override and produce a normal thing here. Protein, as we'll see today, how this links. How the genotype and phenotype are connected today. We'll see that. But yes, this would be considered a carrier, right? And we'll do a practice problem with this. And then of course, this is why we call it X-linked recessive, because if you have two, so this is, you can think of this as, a recessive trait that we've talked about. Remember, recessive traits, you need two recessive alleles in order to have that condition or characteristic, in this case, colorblindness. So this, females need two alleles to be colorblind female. So that's truly the only thing. It's the only reason this is different than what we've been talking about with Mendel and his dominant recessive thing is because males only need one of these recessive alleles and you do get a colorblind male. But this is pretty much the same. Girl power, seriously, you bet. No, males are more frequently have these types of conditions. Hemophilia, colorblindness, muscular dystrophy, things that involve the X chromosome, because we only get one chance. So if we inherit an X chromosome, which comes from mom, by the way, because the mom can't produce a Y chromosome, a gamete, right, that has a Y chromosome because they don't have one, right? Well, anyway, if I get a faulty X, I don't have another one that can compensate. So the, you know, these types of things are more rare in females. You need two from one from both parent. That's not working. Right, let's look at a practice problem and then we can move on to the first, does anyone have any questions about this X-linked recessive traits Okay, cool. All right, so practice problem. Mary gives birth to a son with hemophilia. Okay, but she doesn't have hemophilia. The husband doesn't either. She thinks there must be a mistake. Create a Punnett square to help Mary and her husband understand this family's genetic outcome. So keep this, what we just learned in mind. It'll help you solve it. So give you a few minutes to think about this and then we'll talk about it together. Okay, let's talk about this. So Mary's son has hemophilia, which is an X-linked recessive trait, right? By the way, if I were to give you a problem on the exam, similar to this or whatever, dealing with X-linked genetics, I would mention that, of course. I would say this trait is located on the X chromosome or whatever. I don't put it in here just because it's we're talking about it. But anyway, so Mary has a son with hemophilia, but she doesn't have it. The husband doesn't either. So it's like, how in the heck did this son have hemophilia if neither parent had it? So if we look at the Punnett square that we've set up, well, there's only one option for the husband, so let's start there. He doesn't have hemophilia. Okay, no matter what, that has to be his genotype, normal X chromosome. Because if it were hemophilia gene, then the husband would have it, right? There's only one shot for the males, right? So in this case, does the baby have to be male? You're about to find out. You'll see, yes. I love where your head's at, that you're on the right track here. So now we know the mother has two X chromosomes, right? Now, to solve this problem, well, if this were the case, Then obviously, right, there's no hemophilia allele or gene, so there's no chance, there's no way. Now it mentions Mary does not have hemophilia, so she can't have this. This homozygous situation, she has to be a carrier. Recall that we just learned that it's a recessive genotype, right? So you, if you have one recessive allele, it's not enough for females, right, to have that condition. And so when you do the cross here, there it is, the sun. And this also is, this is why it's more common in males. Again, we're more susceptible here. But the sun has 50% chance. If they have a son, that son has a 50 shot, right? 50% chance of son having hemophilia. This is also why you've heard growing up or your whole life that parents have a 50% chance of having a son or a daughter, right? But in this case, this is why this happened. So it's very interesting, because if the husband and the wife are
Hi
normal,
there.
the wife has is a carrier, that son is more susceptible and can have that genotype and phenotype. Okay. Cool.